something, unmute yourself, and then say whatever you want to say. Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. All right, so we'll continue with the presentation. Yeah, and so essentially the brand is to connect farmers directly to urban and rural customers. There's also the brand needs to be very strong in the B2B space. So we'll talk about that a little further. But these are essentially the values that the MIRI brand stands for. Uplifting small and marginal farmers who own small pieces of land, reducing the number of middlemen between farmer and customer, and creating some understanding between a customer and the farmer so that each can understand each other's lives, requirements, and provide better products and services to each other. So the idea of this webinar is more like to give an overview of what is branding, why it's important, and how branding is important for MIRI as a brand. So for the topics of discussion, we'll talk about, you know, what is branding, why people buy brands, why competing on price is not a good strategy, and what is the real value of a product. So this is more about the introduction of branding, and then what could be the strategies that we can have to form a good branding. So like, who's going to target customer, what are your brand values, what's your brand personality, what's the USP of your product, and what's your brand positioning statement. Branding is a very, very like commonly used words. Some associate it with logos, some associate it with naming. But there's a lot of misconceptions around branding. So branding is not just logo, not just naming, not just strategies. It's a combination of all of these things. So logo is important, but logo in itself is just a visual element. So when you think of Nike, the tick is something that comes to your mind, but there's more associated to a brand like Amul. So, you know, there's more associated with a brand as to what do you feel about a brand. And people think branding can be done overnight, but branding is more like building relationships. So it requires time, commitment, and trust. So, and like to build trust, obviously it requires time. So this is not like a one day or a week thing. It'll take months and years to build strong relationship with your customers. And the other misconception is branding is expensive. So the first thing that we should think about is branding is not an expense. It's more like an investment. If I give you an example of Procter & Gamble, they sold like billions of dollars of product last year through their branding. So how would you associate branding? Branding will help us to improve our sales, improve our revenues, improve our profit margins, and also build a recognition among your customers, build loyalty among the customers. So there are a number of definitions for what's a brand. This one I sort of like, so I put it here. So what is a brand? It's not a logo. It's not just an identity. It's not also just a product. It's more about a person's gut feeling about a product, service, or an organization. So if you think of any big brand, you don't just think about their logo. You also think about, you know, how do you resonate with what it represents and what it stands for. Let's say you're into sports and you want to buy, you can buy any sneakers or any sports shoes, but you want Nike because you see these big personalities wearing it, the sportsmen and achieving like things which normal people can't do. So it gives you sort of a hope that, you know, if I start wearing Nike or something, then I can also do great things in life. So just to give an example, so Apple, you know, is like very famous brand, and so things that would come to mind when you think about Apple, probably technology, innovation, perfection, design, or even Steve Jobs. These would come to your mind on top of your head. But if we dig deeper, there's something more that they want to convey. So I'll show you a video. It's an old advertisement of Apple. We'll just look at the ad.
Here's to the crazy ones. Misfits, the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs in the square holes, the ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules, and they have no respect for the status quo. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify or vilify them. About the only thing you can't do is ignore them, because they change things. They push the human race forward. While some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do.
So if you look at this ad, Apple does not talk about technology, innovation, design, any of that sort. What it does is it talks about, you know, how people feel. And that's why their selling proposition here is, if you use Apple products, you'll be able to think different. You'll be able to do creative work, and you'll be able to achieve great things in life. It's more about a sense of feeling that it's trying to create among its customers. So why do people buy brands? So I've listed three among many reasons: fear of disappointment. So let's say you go to a grocery store, and it's a hot summer day and you're very thirsty. So you see two cola bottles in the fridge. One is Coca-Cola and the other one is some other Coke. So how do you decide which one to buy? I mean, both of them have sugar and not healthy for you, but since you're very thirsty, you have to decide which one to buy. So probably most likely situation, you'll end up buying Coca-Cola because you have used it before and you know how it tastes. So there's a sense of consistency. So the fear of disappointment is one of the things that people are afraid to try new brands. So once your brand is established, you know, you build a trust, okay, that there's some consistency with this brand. Another example, like, why do people buy brands? Because they feel they want to be admired. Why do you think people buy Ferrari or any good car? One, because it has greater performance. The other one is when you're driving a Ferrari or any good car, you feel that, you know, you are special. You want to feel admired. A similar example, people post pictures on Facebook or someplace. It's mostly they want people to see how they look and they want to feel admired. So like, you want to connect with a brand that resonates with your personality. So let's say why someone chooses a Vespa and why someone chooses a motorbike, because someone feels, okay, this personality, and so that's why they make their choice about brands. Competing on value and not on price. So in general, the concept goes like, okay, we need to sell at a price lower than the market price of other competing products. This could be a good strategy if you have deeper pockets. Let's say you are a big, you can take thousands of crores. Then you can undercut your suppliers or competitors and sell at a low. For us, as a small brand, competing on price might not be a good example because we do not have deep pocket. So how do we compete? We can compete on value, something. So instead of focusing on being the best, maybe we should focus on being unique, something different about us. It's not just that people are looking at a price. They're looking at what other value are you providing to them? Maybe it's a healthy lifestyle, transparency where the crop is coming from, the nutritional value in it is higher. So like you say organic, but a lot of people won't trust that it's organic because they don't even know where is the produce coming from. So, and we have to think from the point of a customer when we are interacting with them. It's like we need to wear a lens from the eyes of a customer as to what benefit they are looking for, what benefit we can provide to them. And remember, price is a higher price, then we need to provide some value to them that justifies a higher price. So now branding strategy is mostly is about your customer. So how do we define your customer? What do they care about? What are the values that they hold close to themselves? For us, probably these are some people who care about farmers working in the villages. They care about earth, they care about the soil, they care about the environment in general. They want organic or pesticide-free, healthy, quality food. And then, acting with the customers, we have to identify gaps or the challenges or the pain points of our customers. So once we identify the pain points, then we know what problems we need to solve, and eventually we need to come up with a solution that will make their life easier.
Yeah, so I think it's important also to remember that MIRI and brands that we'll use in general are assets for us. People and they are assets, and they can be seen as assets by different stakeholders. So for example, MIRI as a brand could be seen as an asset to the farmer whose produce you're selling, the end customer who's actually buying that produce, to the business who's buying that produce, and to a lot of different stakeholders that you'll end up interacting with, including government departments, etc. So it's something that gives the work you're doing an identity, and it's something that people who are doing different jobs can recognize, and something that you can leverage. So for example, here in B2C, I think it'll be important to figure out who your ideal customer is to start actually segmenting your customers, because we are selling sort of all food products. So technically anyone who eats food can actually be our customer. But it's important for you to start recognizing that there are different types of customers within this large group, and to start segmenting them and thinking about various offerings to different types of customer segments based on income, based on gender, based on whether they are single or married, based on whether they have children. The products will, of course, vary. The products they're looking for will of course vary. And also the way to communicate them will also vary. All of these customers in general, from what we've seen, launching a lot of these operations in Bangalore, tend to be very price sensitive. They tend to have, quality tends to be very important in terms of taste, consistency. Like Satya was saying, Coca-Cola, every bottle tastes exactly the same. So how can we achieve something similar through good supply chain and through good quality control, etc. Health is also a consideration. And we've seen that typically sustainability can make a difference. The idea of sustainability, the idea that purchasing has improved a farmer's life, can make a difference only if you have already figured out the other three. Only if your price is competitive, only if your quality is great, and only if you're selling healthy products. But sustainability can be a very significant difference in both B2C and B2B market. Some of the pain points that we've seen are that although there all these products do exist in some shape or form in the market, getting it to the customer at the right time when they are looking for it, convenience, and of course, the lack of trust in, for example, organic or in. So there's basically a lot of hesitation when someone makes a claim of being organic or procuring directly from farmers. So how can we actually create that trust and show it to them that we are actually doing this? And of course, what our job becomes is then to actually bring these products, bring the brands to these various stakeholders. In B2B, it's kind of a similar situation. But for example, we met with Everest Masala a couple of weeks ago. We visited their factory. They sell 250 crore packets of masala per year. So basically, they sell the equivalent of 2 packets of masala for every Indian in planet Earth. So, of course, a huge operation. But what we found to be very interesting is that they don't have more than 30, 40 vendors. And these vendors have been with them for decades. So the importance to any business of having reliable vendors, of having vendors that deliver on time, at a good price, with some level of professionalism and quality control previously done, is really, really, really important. And can really make the difference for you. Because in this case, your customer is a business, right? Customer like Everest Masala. So this can really make a difference to them and really give them a competitive advantage in the market if their suppliers are good. It's probably one of the things that's really made Everest Masala the biggest masala company in India, the strength of their vendor base. So like one of you was saying that this example of nearby hotels wanting 4-5 years of supply, it just becomes very important to start doing business and also not be afraid of making a commitment, I guess, in that scenario. Yeah, and get the MIRI brand out to as many potential businesses as possible and continually follow up with them.
And I'll just quickly go through this. So what's the brand value? So this slide I have put in as to just to think as to what, when you go and market your product, first we need to spend some time as to understand our product itself. You know, what value do you associate with your product, your brand? So, you know, everyone's here to help farmers make money, but it's a tricky situation. So what value does that product bring to the end customer? So what other than making? So in some shape or way, it has to be communicated, you know, how or where the product is made, like the crop is grown, and like what does it convey, and how does it make the world a better place, and how does it help a consumer make the world a better place? So let's say if someone is buying from us, how does he or she help in sustainability, in improving the soil or preserving the environment? So, and then this information we can get while interacting with the customer as to, so if we interact with someone for 10 or 20 minutes, we will get to understand, you know, what their beliefs are, what they stand for, what they think about, you know, different things. And from that, we can understand what's the value that they're looking for, so that we can have a strategy for each and every customer. And like I said, authenticity first. Instead of competing on price, let's focus more on what's special about our product and try and convey that to the customer.
So these are some of the values that the MIRI brand stands for. So transparency and traceability to the farmer, the ability to tell the customer that of the 100 rupees they've spent, 56 rupees has actually gone to the farmer's bank account. To be able to prove that to the customer by showing them the bank statement in which this transaction occurred. So actually introducing a model where you can prove and back up what you're saying. Of course, remove middlemen, get farmers directly to sell customers. And all this is on the backdrop of communicating that we are actually here to improve farmer livelihoods.
So, like a brand personality. So, Amul is a very famous brand in India. And so, they have established themselves over the years. I remember this photo that you're seeing on your screen, the Taste of India. And then I think as a child, we all look to Amul, you know, their products were always quality, very delicious, and farmer cooperative society produced products. So why do brands need to have a personality? Let's say when you think of a Thunderbird or something, you think about something, right? Why would I buy it? Because it sort of gives me the sense of, you know, freedom, a rebel inside me, So similarly, if you think of Amul, you think of something that is made in India, that is, you know, done, produced by farmer cooperative society, that something that represents quality, taste. So all these things represent brand personality, and that is what most of the customers associate themselves before making. So in general, if for brand personalities, people generally like it, like to feel associated with it, or aspire to become that sort of a person, that personality which the brand represents. So we'll skip. So this is more about the brand positioning statement. So what for? So this is for MIRI, but I would say wherever you are working, whatever farmers you are working, whatever they are growing. So think in terms of, you know, what is your USP? What is your unique selling proposition? So if I pulse from you, or I buy pulse from a store or from a Reliance place, what is something different that I'll get if I purchase that from you? It could be in terms of taste, it could be in terms of how it's grown, it could be in terms of, you know, where the money that our customer is spending is going. So think about, you know, what's unique about what we are doing, or you in your, you know, working with farmers are trying to sell.
Along this same point, I think it's a very useful activity to do what Shami just said. It'll help you get to know your farmers better. It'll help you get to know what the craft of farming better. It'll help you understand the entire process. And it'll be a really great exercise to find if there's a USP. But I think there will also be lot of situations in which you don't have a USP, in which the farmer is using the exact same processes as the rest of the farmers in the area, is growing the exact same crop, the exact same variety of crop, etc. So there will be situations in which it's difficult to find any USP, and then the job just becomes purely about sales and not really about marketing or branding. So we'll also get into the sales. But before that, we'll just cover this piece about the brand you'll portray when you actually engage with farmers, because that's also a form of communication. That's also a form of branding. Be showing a market-facing brand for customers, which is, you'll need to show a brand to farmers, which is very empathetic about building trust, etc.
So, like, before we get into this, I would just, you know, maybe we can take sort of a break here to understand, like, whatever we said, did it make any sense, or do you need some sort of, you know, clarification? I know this mostly has been about MIRI and branding in general, but I'm hoping that this should give us a how we can think of our products before we make that sales pitch to our customer. So, like, feel free to ask anything or give your suggestions, whatever, and then we can move ahead with the last few slides. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, this is Ramakrishna.
Yeah.
Sir, when you start launching this brand, and when you launch this brand in the initial days, when you launch this brand, I'm talking about the very initial days of this brand.
Yeah.
So how do you interact with and convince the first set of customers, sir? What kind of things you have followed in the very first days of launching and penetrating this brand?
So typically, the first set of customer acquisition tends to be very personal.
Okay.
Friends, family, colleagues.
Yeah.
Finding people who like your idea, who associate with your idea, and then getting them board as champions of the brand themselves. So okay. We launched a successful campaign in apartments nearby, and we got people who were passionate about helping farmers to actually resell our products there.
Okay.
We also launched in an area which we know well. We launched in our own company first before launching other IT companies. So our strategy was to build a group of tech savvy people who like to post on social media, etc., and launch the brand there so that they can become our marketers for us. So we've launched a couple of push carts in other campuses also that are selling vegetables from local farmers. We're seeing that in each IT campus, there's about 5,000-6,000 people, and they're in turn spreading the word in their own networks.
So one more thing to this. So let's say the idea is to drive the conversation as to understand your customers. Let's say I'm talking to someone and I ask them, like, you know, do you know, like, the food that you're buying, only 10-15% of the price that you're paying actually goes to the farmer, and it's all mostly the... A lot of people are they don't know these specifics, and so but I don't have an option to buy this. And then you say, like, okay, so we have a brand where we are, you know, whatever we are selling, bulk of the revenue goes directly to the farmers in helping them earn a dignified lifestyle. So you have to in some ways drive that conversation where they understand why you are doing it. What you are doing it is okay, like, okay, I'm selling crop, but why I'm selling crop? Because I care for the farmers. I want them to have a sustainable, a good life, and so that farming becomes profitable and people do it in the right way. I think it's there's no fixed rule. We are also trying to figure it out. We all are sort of trying to figure it out, and it's an exercise that we are all doing, and we can share as to what your experiences are going ahead, and we can use it in our branding as well.
Yeah, but I still would say that our number one, in order of preference for the customer, it's been about price first and foremost. It has to be competitive price wise, then about quality, about if there's health benefit, finally about farmer impact. We have to secure the first three before building a successful brand.
Sir, I interacted with some of the direct consumers as well as the business persons who are acting as a middleman.
Okay.
So what are actually they are looking? Example, if you take the direct consumers, in my cluster, the major crop is vegetables and rice. See, if I deliver anything to the home, they are not looking for one or two varieties of vegetables. They are at least looking for 4 to 5 varieties of vegetables.
Sure.
But my major challenge here is in my in cluster, only 2 to 3 varieties are there.
Yeah.
So how do we convince the customers, you know, in only for these 2 to 3 varieties? Or else we have another point here is, sir, we all are working in 8 districts, sir. We all 8 people are working in 8 different districts. Where Sumant is working, the onion is very huge, production is there. Where Madhukar Reddy sir is working, there's a lot of mirchis available.
Okay,
if we all are able to, you know, exchange the products from here to there, we can benefit the lot of farmers as well as the lot of customers. The customers also looking one who can deliver more number of products.
Yeah.
So even if I deliver 2-3 things, they want to go out and buy something which is not available which is not available with us. Please, sir.
Yeah, were you also the person who asked about transportation?
Transportation, I think there's a challenge is there, but we can solve it because the road connectivity is there from there to here. You know, my cluster is here where I'm selling these things. It's almost 150 to 180 kilometers away.
Go ahead.
Yeah, we can get here, sir, and we are planning to take a person from, and yesterday I speak to Praveen, sir. He said, sir, recruit a person in the apartment itself and give some kind of margin. That's better for you rather than you can't go every time to that place.
Yeah, Yeah. So yeah. I think in general, part of the fellowship needs to have the objective to actually win the farmer's trust.
Yes.
And there's a couple of different ways to do that, but I think the most straightforward way to do it is to get them connected to market.
So yeah, I understand your point, sir. Initially, when I connect at least two to three farmers, they started believing me. Once they believe me, I can say them to change the crop pattern.
If you look at the economics of it, if a farmer owns a two acre plot of land, for example, a small farmer, and he's growing something, if he's growing fruits and vegetables, that might lead to a one and a half ton output per year.
Yes.
How many individual customers do you have to onboard to sell 1.5 tons worth of vegetables? A lot, right?
Yes, yes.
Do that for 10 farmers, that's about 20, 30 tons of produce.
Yes.
And probably about 100, 200 families.
Yes.
And there also this added complication of course, one family is not just a cucumber or onion. They need an entire spread of products. So I would say most straightforward, the most low-hanging fruit here of the early stages is to build B2B channels. And not saying we shouldn't do B2C if there's someone in an apartment.
Yes, yes. And I understand your point, sir. B2C is very difficult. B2B, directly we can sell to the bulk. Initially, I have spoken to some of the farmers. If you are producing 100 cages, I will take maybe 10 cages or 20 cages. Please support in the initial days.
Yeah, that's a great strategy. Because their margin will also be much, much higher for B2C.
Yeah.
Right. But I'm just saying that the strategy of getting, onions from 150 kilometers away and getting something else from 200 kilometers away for one customer definitely won't work out.
Yes.
Maybe for a large apartment building, it might work out. But try to think of more realistic solutions. Like if you're getting, if say you have three out of four products which a customer wants, you can source it from somewhere else. Nothing is stopping you from doing that. If you have onion, chili, tomato, but you don't have potato, and you know your customer will want potato, you should be able to source potato from the market.
I think this conversation is a good segue as to in terms of this slide, engaging with farmers. So as a fellow, you have to wear, or we all as market linkage guys have to wear a couple of hats. One is our interaction with the farmers, and the other is our interaction with our customers or with the market, so that we can find ways in which we can connect these two. So we have to sort of create that marketplace. So like Navrun said, if someone wants four types of vegetables, and we only have two types of vegetables, so then maybe we can complete the basket. Because the important thing right now maybe is initial days, we have to mold ourselves more towards what the customer wants. And once we can push that, we have like customers get you to buy two from us, probably sir you buy the rest two from other marketplace. So in terms of first would be the building trust with the farmers. This I had an interaction with Pramil ji gave a webinar last time, right? There is a lot of experience working with farmers, and then I was asking him as to how we sell our produce to the customers. He's selling engagement with the farmers. So he's telling, building trust with farmers. So he's saying, trust building is not something that, okay, you go to a village and then you start farmers. These guys are very down to earth. They're not very educated and very simple. So maybe during your initial interaction, what will happen is, they might not give you any sign of assurance. Then it becomes very important that how you pitch your front of the farmers. It's like selling yourself to a farmer, right? Why you are here, which company you're working for, what is your end goal? They need to see what's your vision. So maybe once you have a strong introduction, they might start discussing among themselves, okay, why this guy is here? Is he just here for some benefit? He wants to do some research and go. So they need to understand why you are here. And then the other thing, important thing was, we have to understand the dynamics of the village. Maybe me going to a village or you going to a village and just speaking to the farmer, they might not just trust us. But there are people in the farmer who have influence, who people listen to. So it's important to understand what's the dynamics of the village, understand which people, maybe the Gram Panchayat has a lot of influence in the village. So maybe approaching them, including them in some sort of a talk so that this message gets conveyed through them, because it will help the farmers also believe in us and build trust. The other thing was, let's say, what happens after 1 year? Because we want this to run on its own without our intervention. That's why identify a farmer champion. So when you are working with let's say a group of 20, 30 farmers, so you will not be doing the sales for the next 10 years or so. We want to identify a farmer champion. So along with working with the farmers, the idea is to farmers start not just being a farmer, but also start thinking in terms of an entrepreneur or as a collective group of farmers acting as an organization. Okay, so we as a collective unit, what can we achieve? How do we understand the market and what tactics can we deploy to sell our produce? So it's important to identify a farmer champion, work with them closely, and when you go sell or talk to a customer, take them with yourself so that when such a discussion happens, like who's gonna do it after 1 year, you say this guy, he'll take care of it, sir. He works with 50 people. We are producing 500 kilos or 550 tons of this, and rest assured we'll be selling it to you the next 5-6 years. This guy will give you the assurance. We as a MindTree employee, we do not deal, or we are not here to make money, but we are here to facilitate this process. And then understanding your crop USP. So there are two USPs. One is probably a natural USP. So some crops will grow probably in some areas. So that could be a selling point. So if you want something unique in India, this only grows in my region. So you try it. You eat it once, you'll see how it tastes different.
Your Guntur chili.
Yeah.
No, what is a USP? Just
like unique selling proposition. It's like what's unique about my paddy or my pulse. So natural is something that grows in one area, doesn't grow anywhere else. So maybe the size of the paddy is big, or it has less starch in it. Could be anything. This information can be extracted by working with the farmer. So whatever they are producing, we need to understand how they are producing, get into the depths of it so that we can create that USP. So I think it would be good exercise to understand what our farmers are producing, how much they are producing, when they are producing, what's important, what's different about it. Is the product USP, probably what method they are using for farming. All of this information, when you go and talk to a buyer or a customer, so let's say you come and you talk to me and say, I'm here to sell 20 kilos of rice. I'll say, okay, I'll buy it from Big Basket. Why do I buy it from there? Then you can say, sir, do you know where your crop is coming from? Whatever. So, and when you say, this has been produced here, this is how it has been produced, that brings sense of, one, it shows that you are very knowledgeable, you are expert in this field, and your suggestion makes sense, or whatever you are saying would resonate with the customer. Then look at the other side of it, like working with the customer. So one is you try and convince them with your USP. Okay, but there could be situations where we don't have a USP. And we are here to sell our paddy. Then it becomes important to talk to our customer and understand what is their pain point or what they are looking for in a crop or in a product. Identify those gaps, think about it, and then, okay, sir, let's say you want 8 a.m. every morning, or he says, oh, you know what, I have to walk 2 kilometers every day to get something. Then we find a, we have such 10 customers who are saying we don't like walking to the market 2 kilometers every day. So then we sort of delivered those 10 customers. The idea is to start getting those transactions happening. Let us get our foot in the door. First transaction probably will be the toughest. If our product is good, if we are honest in our efforts, if our produce is like really different from others, and if we show passion, and that should come across in our interaction with our customers. Also, let's say you go meet a bulk buyer. So this example again was given to us by a guy who works with NGO called Vritti. And he said, like, you know, you need to understand. You will go to a customer and you say, okay, so we are selling this, we can provide you 500 tons. He'll say, I'm not interested in 500 tons of paddy. Everyone's selling 500 tons of paddy. But what I'm looking for 10:2:2 parameter. So probably the farmers don't even know that there is such a parameter that exists. They're just growing it, storing it, and then going to the mandi, selling it. Whoever is bidding the highest, they're selling it. If no one's bidding, then they are ready to sell it at whatever price because they want to get rid of their inventory that very same day. So understanding what parameters in terms of quality our bulk buyers are looking for, you know, document it or understand it in some way, convey it to your farmer champion and through them to the group of the farmers. They should understand what is valued in the market. And then they can align their produce with what is valuable in the market. Again, let's say, and then some of the things that I've written here is like, you know, understand as to invoice pattern. So when you do the negotiation, let's say they say, okay, we'll pay you to 14 rupees per. But we have to be very clear in terms of what does that mean? Let's say you commit, okay, so we'll sell you at 14. And once you go there, they say, okay, this is, you know, excluding GST, you pay the GST. So the thing is, we need to have a clarity with our customer so that the terms and conditions are set from the very beginning. We have to understand that, you know, a lot of energy and effort has been spent in getting those leads. We are provided with the list of 300. Leads, and whenever your customer, we at least get some set of transaction. The idea is to get our foot in the door and from there take it forward.
Also important to for the negotiations to be clear. So does the price, the final price, include the cost of gunny bags, include the cost of transportation, include GST? So very important to have clarity during negotiations and with bulk buyers. We also have listed some compliances here. But we can get further into detail with that with the next session with Mr. CPC, who is who heads the sales and marketing efforts from Vritti. So, but what we need to highlight is that in Indian government and Indian law, there's no compliance requirement for an individual farmer. An individual farmer can sell his products anywhere he wants to anyone he wants by law. We've listed a couple of compliances that an FPO, I think you guys would know what an FPO is by now, farmer producer organization or farmer producer company, needs to actually do business. But we can get into, we can share some documentation with you on that and get into some further details on this. That's the end of our presentation. Before we open up to questions, I can also talk a little bit about the issues you guys highlighted when you introduced yourselves. Should I go ahead and do that before we ask questions?
Yeah, please, sir.
Okay, great. Yeah. So one of you raised this issue of challenge to mobilize consumers.
Yes.
So, of course, that is a huge challenge. It's not an easy task. So I would say just try and get your products to them. So for example, this, I think there's one of you renting an apartment model.
Ramakrishna.
Rahul is piloting in an apartment model. It could be a sensible model, given that cost of distribution is low. You just have to bring one vehicle to the apartment. Cost of marketing is also low, because once you're there for a few days, everyone in the apartment knows that you're there. So, for example, this solution is now really a sales solution. You need to get to that apartment association owner, and you need to convince him that what you're doing is the right thing to do.
Yes.
So you'll be able to crack these customers if you just this one sales deal with this decision maker. So focus on that. And your USP there is, of course, that this is a socially beneficial program for farmers, that you're going to be bringing healthy produce to the residents. So it's a win-win for residents as well as for farmers. If I'm not sure if you're working with a ZBNF area, but organic or natural could be a great USP for the apartment owner as well. So I'm saying, when you have a USP, show your USP. If you don't have a USP, just show value, that you're cost effective, that you're benefiting farmers, etc.
Yeah.
And then someone also raised this issue of transportation being too expensive. So becomes basically the important calculation here is how many kilos are you transporting and at what price. So once you get, so of course with low volumes, transportation is very expensive. The more weight you're transporting, the cheaper it gets. So just think about when it makes sense to hire a vehicle. So if you're serving 5 customers in 5 different areas, of course, renting even a Tata Ace won't make sense. Maybe it would just be riding a bike and fulfilling the deliveries on your own. So yeah, just look at the unit economics of transportation. We're definitely here to help you with that. And I think on one of you raised the issue of post-harvest management. So both post-harvest management and B2B bulk, I think a strategy that's worked really, really effectively for us is to involve the farmer in this. So, for example, we were working with pepper farmers in Tamil Nadu. So, yeah, for pepper, it becomes very, very important to dry quickly. Otherwise, if there's moisture, fungus comes, and you'll have to re-dry it, wash it, rewash it, etc. So we found it difficult to convince farmers to spend the time required to dry until we brought someone from Big Bazaar, someone from Future Group, to the farmer. He checked the moisture in front of them and he showed them that this at this moisture level, this is the best price you'll get. So that showed the farmer that someone has actually come from a company, he's brought some equipment, he knows what he's doing. So this is a legitimate claim all of a sudden, right? That you can't have more than X percent moisture. And then the farmer starts to respect that. He sees, yeah, this is not the market value. I mean, this is the market value of the quality that I'm providing. So I have to change some post-harvest technique. Same for finding bulk buyers. Becomes crucial to bring these parties together to show your farmer that you're working, to show that your farmer that you found him a customer, and then for your customer to also communicate what is required from a quality perspective back to your farmer. So bringing farmers into the process becomes crucial for all these kinds of activities. So I think we'll open up to questions now.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, when we sell the rice to the customers, do we want any kind of, you know, GST number or any some such kind of thing? You know, is it legal to sell directly to the customers right from the farmers' gate?
It varies. You can check up on HSN codes, but typically unpackaged food grains attract zero GST. But when they are packaged, and it can sometimes even depend on what kind of packaging, then they'll start to attract GST. So your branded packaged rice will probably have a 5% GST. That's a guess. I'm not sure. Probably have a 5% GST. Branded and packed. But your gunny bag rice, 100 kilo gunny bag of rice, won't attract any GST.
Sir, if I sell through a cooperative society, is it take the same 5% GST? For companies, it is taking 5%. I think a former cooperative society also wants to pay 5%.
A farmer producer company will still have to pay GST. Depending on it depends mostly on the product.
Okay.
Less on who is selling it.
Yeah. My problem here is, you know, before I sell, I'm checking all the things. And if any kind of legal issues will arise, like, you know, GST problems or something else kind of things.
Yeah, so we'll have a more detailed section with detailed session with CPC, sir. He knows all of this in and out during the sales session. To the best of my knowledge, if you're selling unpackaged, unbranded, there's no GST.
Okay. But you know this, you know it very well, sir. It's unpackaged and kind of things, people are not willing to see it also sometimes. Need this, some of the this, you know, premium people are already habituated with this branded things.
What product are you talking about?
I'm talking about rice and this black gram.
So does this cooperative that you're working with already has a
package? Yeah, rice is available, sir.
Sorry?
Rice is available.
Do they have it branded packaged?
No, sir. You know, if we are able to attach this MIRI brand on that, maybe sales pitch will be more.
Yeah. Don't worry about legal. Go ahead and do it.
We are
covering you legally.
Okay.
Ram.
Okay, sir.
Ram.
Hello. Yes, sir.
Yeah. And you don't no need to worry about GST at this point, because GST will start applicable only if your turnover is more than 20 lakhs.
20 lakhs, yeah.
Okay, sir. Okay.
You can freely do whatever you want to do, like regarding packaging.
Yes, sir. I don't know about it, you know, that's why I'm asking this.
If you have a turnover of 20 lakhs, then we'll tell you what.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir. My target is 20 lakhs.
Great. B2B target should be much higher.
Oh, yeah.
Madhukar, you have any doubts? You are also doing in the same lines, right? Direct marketing customers.
Madhukar, I think you're muted.
Madhukar, unmute. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Any questions?
No, sir. Okay.
Good. Okay, then. Did you guys find this session useful?
Really useful, sir. We don't know some of the things. I know some of the things I really don't know. It's like a thought provoking. I don't know what is this USP. I can't know about it.
Okay. Yeah. Honestly, I think branding is, it's important to understand. It's important for you guys to understand how to use the MIRI brand.
Yeah. Yes. Yes.